Hi, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the HDFC Securities 333 Premier Webinar. Today, we are going to discuss the outlook on pharma sector. I'm your host, Payal Pandya, from the Investment Advisory Team, and with us to discuss this subject, we have Bansi Desai, who has been tracking this sector for over a decade and has joined HDFC Securities about a year ago. Hi, Bansi, welcome.
Thank you, Payal, for hosting me.
Bansi, the Indian pharma industry is about the third largest in terms of, drug producer in terms of volume and manufactures about 60% of the vaccines globally. And India also operates about 250 US FDA and MHRA approved plants. And the API market is expected to reach about $6 billion by the end of calendar year 20. So with such hold on the industry, why is it that we have seen the pharma sector underperform over the last 5 years compared to the broader indices, and overall sentiment has been a little fearful? While in the last 6 months, of course, it has outperformed. But what's your take on it? What has gone behind it?
Okay, so at the outset, good afternoon, everyone, and I wish all of you are safe and healthy in these testing times. So to answer your question, Payal, let me delve a bit into the history, as to why this underperformance. So for Indian companies, two key geographies are extremely important in terms of revenue contribution. So US and India, both these markets, they account for almost 60 to 70% of the top line for Indian companies. And clearly these two markets had seen some severe headwinds in the last 3 to 4 years. So in the US, which is the largest market globally in terms of drugs, here, the channel, which is the wholesalers, the PBMs, which are the middlemen, so to speak, between the customer and manufacturers, that witnessed a big consolidation. So today, there are three purchasing organizations in the US, which accounts for almost 90% of drug purchases in the world. So they kind of, exerted a lot of pricing pressure on these Indian manufacturers and even the other manufacturers, the generic players especially. So what happened is that, the market, which used to see a price erosion of 3 to 4%, that erosion went as high as to 12 to 15% when these guys consolidated. This is almost 3-4 years back. So what happened is that, year over year, the base in the US kept on declining for Indian companies. So while there were new launches which were kind of offsetting this pressure, but because the extent of erosion was so severe that, most of these companies actually witnessed a decline in the US growth. So that was one bit on the fundamental aspect of the US. Secondly, also what happened, as you would know and appreciate that US FDA, the regulatory standards became quite stringent, and the number of inspections, the frequency of inspections kind of increased globally, and for Indians especially, because India is such a big contributor to the generic medicines in the US. So we account for almost 40 to 45% of the volume share in the US, and therefore clearly we also have more number of plants outside US. So therefore the frequency of inspection kind of increased, the standards of FDA also got stringent. And this kind of led to a lot of warning letter and, import alert situation, which kind of, made these plants redundant in a way that, we did not see any approvals when these facilities were under US FDA scanner. So on one side, you had pricing pressure, which was eroding your base. And on the other side, you had these plants, which were actually not seeing approvals because of these various issues. So both these issues put together kind of, led to the severe headwinds in the US business, which now has stabilized, at least in terms of pricing pressure. The channel has kind of, understood that beyond a point, we cannot squeeze these manufacturers. Otherwise, they will see supply shortages and all of that. So prices have now kind of gradually stabilized from there. So that was on US. And secondly, also in India, what happened is that there was this introduction of NLEM, which is the National List of Essential Medicines, which led to price capping of certain essential medicines. So that kind of impacted the growth for a year. And then following that, we had a year of GST, which kind of disrupted the growth. There was inventory adjustments. There was even demon impact. Also in between, there were certain FTC, so fixed dose combinations, which were banned by government. So all of these factors put together kind of dented the growth of the India market. So India traditionally, which used to grow at 10-12%, the growth here actually slid. And for the last 4 or 5 years, the industry has actually grown at 7-8%. So these two were the biggest markets which saw the headwinds and kind of impacted the growth for most of the companies. So despite the run-up that we have seen in the last 6 months in pharma, on a five-year basis, the sector has still massively underperformed the Nifty benchmark.
So Bansi, do you think that the US FDA issues are now behind us? Are the regulations going to be continuing to be so stringent? Is it going to still hamper the kind of growth in the near term? What's your take on it?
Sure. So today the FDA is not able to come here and inspect because they have restriction on travel. Physically they cannot come here for inspection, but there are guidelines which about to get implemented, where there is a possibility of them doing a desktop audit of plants. We haven't seen an instance of them doing so yet, but they are in the process of developing those kind of guidelines. So in the US locally, they have started to kind of go out and inspect facilities where the COVID cases are not very high. But globally, I think it would take some time for FDA to actually come down and do physical inspection. So until that time, we could see them going the virtual route of inspection, and that could actually be beneficial for these companies, especially the ones which have had issues for many years, who have kind of remediated on their side, who are done with the resolution and everything, but are just waiting for the FDA nod. So what we are seeing is that FDA is getting proactive in terms of deciding as to how do we help these companies come out of inspection. So at least in the near term, I believe that what will happen is that you may not see additional risk of plants getting under the FDA scanner. At the same time, some of the plants which are important from US point of view, US would choose to do desktop review. And if that goes well, then it will help companies to come out of the issues.
Okay, but should we understand that this might also be a little short-lived, and once everything normalizes, they will actually do another round of audit and, may or may not come up with
you're very
possible,
right.
Right?
You're right in your observation, because I don't see a reason why, US will actually kind of, lower its standards, so to speak.
Correct, absolutely.
In terms of, compliance standards, expectations. So over a longer term, that will always remain the biggest risk for this sector.
So how do you see the growth in the longer term coming out? I mean, US being one of the largest markets for Indian companies, India being the other, and then European countries. So in this pie, how do you see, with a lot of other, see, regulatory is going to remain a concern, even maybe short-lived, some short-lived ease as of now, but of course FDA will kick in, and while companies will have to adhere to their regulations, it might take time, and this could bring about a slower growth even in the near future. And in all of this, Bansi, in this COVID times, we are also talking about, sourcing a lot of APIs and everything within the country domestically, instead of taking it from China, which used to be one of our larger markets for sourcing APIs and other materials. So how feasible is that? Is it also short-lived, that only to some extent we can do this, build in, you know, manufacture internally? Or is it actually going to be a switch where, of course, we used to import from China because of cost benefits, which now might have to be compromised a little bit, that might eat into the margins? And then, of course, we have NELP here, which will not allow us to go beyond a certain point in terms of, you know, passing on the cost to the end users. So how sustainable is this whole model?
Okay, so multiple questions. So I'll address it. The first part, which is, you know, which part of pie looks interesting to me. So going by the markets that we are present in, India is almost 30% of revenues for Indian companies, and here I think we will see some disruption in the next 1 year because of COVID. The growth will be lower, but over a longer period of time, clearly the demographics, etc., are favorable, and therefore over a longer period, this market will kind of see a linear growth of 8 to 10%. And then Indian companies, which has higher chronic share, will kind of, you know, do better than the industry. So this business will grow at an easy, double-digit, low double-digit kind of growth rate. When it comes to US, here there are two parts. Companies with a smaller base in the US will actually see a non-linear growth. In the sense, because the fact that they have a lower base, and therefore those approvals will add meaningfully to their base, the growth prospects looks decent, and therefore all and therefore for them, even a meaningful product opportunity can swing the earnings growth profile. So for a company with a smaller size, the outlook in the US remains very good. It depends obviously on the pipeline and the execution as to, when they're getting timely approvals, their plans are clear, etc. But having said that, the growth prospects in the US will be a lot higher than what you see in India. For the larger companies, which have a very big base in the US, for them to materially grow will be a challenge, clearly. So a company with $1 billion size in the US, even if they launch 10, 20 products, now unless these products are meaningful in size, it will not add to the growth. So clearly they need to invest into more complex opportunities, more risky projects, so to speak, which could, give them those, bigger revenue per product kind of share. So for larger companies, over a longer period, the growth in the US will be around, mid-single digit or so. For a smaller company, it could be higher. Exports market, apart from US, looks very interesting now. Because what these companies are doing is that they are replicating their US portfolio in Europe. Also in the ROW market, a lot of markets are branded generic in nature, which are very similar to Indian market. These companies have done a very good job in terms of, getting market share away from the local companies who are out there. So in the ROW market, in the EU market, we believe that the growth potential also looks good. Coming to API part, now here, let me tell you, so for Indian companies, API today is a very small portion of the revenues, okay? It's between 10 to 15%. Now, over the years, what has happened is that our dependence on China has increased. So for almost 60 to 70% of our raw materials, we have dependence on China. Within India, while we have the manufacturing skill sets, we have the manufacturing capability to produce these APIs, there are certain raw materials like intermediates, which are used in the formulation of drugs, or KSM, which is key starting material, which goes into manufacturing of these APIs. These are even today sourced from China. So direct, indirect dependence on China today is very high. So with the COVID, and also in the past because of the environmental issues in the China, the country and in general the manufacturers have realized the importance of having a good manufacturing base in India, and now more so because even globally people want to de-risk from China. So they want to adopt China plus one strategy where, they will look to Indian companies as an additional, source of manufacturer, which is even reliable. So clearly the outlook for API, structurally looks very good. The point is, you know, how competent we would be when it comes to cost. So over the years, the gap between, you know, the pricing of Chinese API and Indian APIs have reduced to quite an extent. And today the gap, I would say, is anywhere between 10 to 30%. So that's the advantage which China has. And clearly the advantage is because of the scale at which they manufacture. Now, it will be difficult for us to match their scale clearly. You know, that will take some time to happen. And but meanwhile, what will happen is that for certain essential products, like, you know, the government has put out this PLI scheme where they have identified critical 53 APIs for which they want to kind of, you know, improve the manufacturing in India. So for those set of products, we will see investments. And we will see, you know, the demand outlook being strong, not just locally from the domestic players, but also globally. So there, I think, you know, it will be beneficial for companies which are in the small, you know, MSME space, because the whole API space is dominated by these MSME companies. So they stand to benefit clearly out of this, because the demand is good. If the government is providing incentives, I mean, right now the incentives which are listed by the government don't appear to be very promising, but at the same time, it's still a start. So gradually, you know, over a period of time, these companies would benefit. In terms of cost escalation, while there could be some escalation, but in many cases, these prices are also passed on. So for a formulator, you know, if they see that 10-20% price increase in the API sourcing, you know, today they don't mind paying that if that is securing the supply of the drug. Even globally, people are looking at the reliability and, you know, consistency of supply than just pricing. So we will have an advantage over China in terms of costing. In the past, we have seen that whenever there has been a very sharp increase in price in the raw materials, the government also have kind of, you know, relaxed these ceiling prices. So in India, while we have NLEM and which has banned, you know, which has capped ceiling prices of certain products, wherever there have been, you know, increase on account of raw material pricing shooting up, the government has raised the kind of, you know, ceiling prices for those drugs. So we have to take care of the whole ecosystem out here, and you know, the industry body always makes so they keep on making presentations to the government in terms of whether it is feasible or economically viable for them to produce at an X price. So those factors are taken into consideration, in my view, and should not hamper, you know, the profitability of the manufacturers at the end of the day.
Okay, that's well explained, Bansi. Bansi, in all of this, what is the share of Indian pharmaceutical companies in the global pie? How are they placed in the market?
So, well, I mean, we are considered, you know, pharmacy of the world. And in terms of global generic contribution, I would say, you know, we almost account for 20% you know, of the share. In vaccines, we have a very high share. So we produce almost 60-70% of the world's vaccine requirement. In US, our share is very high. So in US generic industry, the Indian companies account for almost 45% to 50% share. And that too, in an oral solid products, the share would be even more higher, you know, compared to the other injectables or other complex categories or biosimilars. So we are very high in terms of generic penetration in the US.
Okay, so then in that case, where are we seeing the actual growth coming in? Say mid to long term, where's in which category of you know, products do you think the growth is likely to pick up sooner, and which might lag to some extent, and what are the companies that are, you know, catering largely to these sectors, these product categories, I would say.
Okay, so within India, clearly, you know, there has been a therapeutic shift, you know, in the last decade. The chronic segment, you know, which comprises of therapies like cardiac, diabetes, onco, asthma, So they account for almost one third of the market share. And over the last decade, what we've seen is that, you know, this particular segment, the chronic segment, has gained almost 500 basis points of market share away from the acute segment. So acute segment largely comprises of therapies like anti-infectives. So clearly, you know, with the improving hygiene standards, you know, and now more so because, you know, people are not stepping out of the house, they are wearing masks, etc. The incidence of anti-infectives is likely to go down. So that is a segment which will kind of see lower growth. At the same time, because of the lifestyle disorder, the chronic therapies, which are like cardio diabetes, they will continue to grow. So we are seeing higher growth in the chronic therapies, especially in a country like India, that will continue for the next decade. We believe that, you know, cardio and diabetes, just these two therapies will account for almost 30% of the share in the next 10 years. So they are growth rate will be higher than the industry. Globally, in the US, the market is dominated by onco drugs. So these oncology drugs are patented drugs. You know, they are big in size and therefore they account for a larger share. However, for a generic player, like, you know, from an Indian company's perspective, because we target the generic market, here in the next 2-3 years, the patent expiries are more towards biologic products. And therefore, biosimilars will see a bigger opportunity in the next 3-4 years compared to in the past where, you know, a lot of conventional chemical-based products which went off patent and we kind of, you know, latched upon that opportunity. So going forward in the US, it will be because our generic penetration is already very high and therefore, as I said, for a bigger company, it will be a challenge to really grow in double digit. But biosimilars in general will see the bigger pie in terms of opportunity.
Okay, Bansi, so right now everybody is talking about APIs and pharma sector, you know, and the growth, especially in the last 6 months, we have seen that everybody wants to invest in a pharma stock. So that's how the rally. What do you think is this rally? Where do you think is this rally in the pharma sector going to go? And how can we be sure with, you know, the near-term growth likely to remain a little moderate and then benefit coming in the longer term? How do you see this panning out? And do we fear that what happened with the pharma sector in FY17-18 would not repeat? What's your take on this?
So, you know, you're right in pointing out. So this that in the past, you know, we have, while the sector remains a bottom-up sector, we have seen phases where, you know, there have been cycles. Like between 2010 and 2015, we saw a bull run where, you know, the companies invested in the US and we kind of grew on a very small base out there. You know, we participated in the patent expiry and all of that. Between 2015 and 2020, we had, like, you know, host of issues which I discussed earlier. And that kind of, you know, led to a bearish phase. Today, what has happened is that, you know, because of the COVID, clearly, you know, it is clearly understood that the sector's relative resilience is quite, you know, high because it's an essential goods at the end of the day. And therefore, you know, relatively speaking, the sector stands out. Also, structurally speaking, there have been certain positives. So as you mentioned about API, you know, globally people want to de-risk and therefore are looking at Indian companies. You know, even the growth outlook in other ROW markets, you know, are looking is looking very interesting. In overall, in general, the currency is also helping. So all of these factors, you know, are favoring the exports business today. And in the near term, I believe that you know, this momentum will continue. So the demand outlook, the order books of the company, they look very interesting if one were to take 2-3 year view. And therefore, I believe that in the near term, it's the export business, you know, continue to do well. Domestic business will take some time to kind of normalize, but this is a business which offers a secular growth. So from a longer term perspective, India is a market which will give you a secular growth of 8-10% over a longer period of time. Whereas one need to, you know, kind of capitalize on the shorter term opportunities which arise on account of COVID and all of that in the exports market. I personally believe that the rally in pharma, while a lot has kind of, you know, the valuations have kind of, you know, gone up, they're still not at the peak level. So the sector, you know, on an average has traded at a premium of almost 40% to Nifty in the last 10 years. And today that premium, despite the rally, is anywhere between 25 to 30%. So we still have some room to kind of, you know, increase in terms of valuations. The outlook for these, you know, geographies look good. Companies also have taken a lot of cost containment measures, which has actually, you know, made the margins also quite resilient, so to speak. So we have a situation where your demand outlook is looking good, your costs are actually in control, and therefore the margin trajectory looks to be good. The currency is also, you know, adding to that. So all of these factors are clearly favoring the sector, and therefore we are seeing earnings growth. And till the time the earnings kind of, you know, continue, also should kind of sustain, you know, from these levels. So I think in the near term, the rally should continue. Over a longer term period, it will be a bottom up, you know, story, depending upon companies, their positioning in therapies, their positioning in market, their size, the valuations, all of that will matter as to which companies will kind of emerge as winners over a longer term.
So Bansi, very quickly, which means that while the growth is likely to be a little slower in the near to mid-term, the valuations might continue to increase, and should we or should we not fear a correction? Because, see, valuations will really be justified once the growth also comes to a double-digit or higher single-digit levels. So we should not fear of a correction there? Is that what you're trying to indicate?
So clearly, I mean, in the near term, the growth will continue. But I would caution that one should not extrapolate the quarter which has gone by. So this quarter, also what happened is that, you know, because of the lockdown, companies saved a lot of sales and promotion costs. And therefore, that kind of, you know, led to a very good margin expansion and, you know, earnings kind of surprised positive. Clearly, will this continue? We don't think so. You know, as and when the lockdown kind of eases and things normalize, you know, these costs are going to come. Do extrapolate this Q1, you know, into the next four quarters. But at the same time, the growth levers are in place. The markets are favoring, you know, in general, U.S. of Indian companies. They want the plans to get resolved. They are approving some of the products which are required for COVID or respiratory segment, etc. So you have an environment which is conducive for growth. Therefore, you know, earnings growth, at least of a double digit, should continue over a longer period of time is what we need. So to that extent, I don't see, you know, a sharp correction in the sector. The premiums actually
Yeah. So Bansi, in that case, what would be your top picks in the large and mid cap segment? If you had to, if somebody had to invest in this sector right now, what are those 3-4 stocks that you would really bank on?
So I would want to play the export story, and therefore, from that perspective, we Aurobindo and Lupin, both these. Stocks. So both these companies have a very good presence in the US and a very good pipeline as well. And therefore, from a US perspective, I believe, you know, there are possibilities of them surprising on the upside. Lupin also has a very good domestic franchise with a very strong hold in chronic therapies like diabetes. You know, respiratory, they're very strong in those therapies, which will continue to do well. And also, it's very important to have a good domestic business because that kind of supports your valuation. And therefore, given that the valuations are already strong, from what they were 6 months back, one would also want some comfort on valuation when they're investing today. So Lupin is one stock which has comfort on valuation, which has a strong domestic business, which will kind of, help the company put out a strong double-digit growth over a longer period of time in the U.S. There are some of the plants which are stuck because of the warning letter, etc. So if FDA chooses kind of to affect these plants, then you have that as a major catalyst, which can, lead to the upsides. So there's a lot of costs sitting in your P&L, but because these plants are not cleared, the operating leverage is not played out. So we
could expect... What I was coming at, was this also not act as a hindrance since a lot of plants are stuck as of now? What if the delay is longer and it doesn't pan out as expected?
So their plants have been under the issue last 3 to 4 years. And in the near term, there are certain important products which are going to drive the revenue, which are not from these plants. So there are other plants which are cleared, and those products are from the plants which are, absolutely fine when it comes to FDA's compliance standards. And therefore, in the near term, we believe that the growth will be driven by, them getting approvals for these key products on time, which are not dependent on the facilities which have issues. Mm-hmm. Also, what they've done is that because these facilities have been under issue for the last 3-4 years, the critical products companies tend to kind of shift to the other plants. So they refile it from the other plant, and now they will start to see approvals from those plants. So the process is in place, and therefore we believe that in the 2-3 years, even if the plants don't come out of critical products will actually come and drive the growth in the near term.
Okay. Great. I think in the interest of time, I'll ask you one last question, because right now we have been in under a lockdown for more than half a year now. Okay. And every pharma company, almost every pharma company, is in the race of finding out that one drug which will, be a vaccine to COVID. So supposing once a company invents that COVID drug, how does the market then work with it? Is it, would they be having a patent for it? And then is it that we should expect, the contract manufacturers to benefit more? Or how are the other researchers that are going on will react to that?
Okay, so now there are two things here. One is that there is a lot of research happening on the drugs which are repurposed for COVID treatment, and the other bit is vaccine. Clearly it looks like, some of the vaccines are quite ahead in the race, like we know of Pfizer, Moderna, or AstraZeneca. There's also Sinopharm in China. So these 3-4 companies are well ahead in terms of race, in terms of developing the vaccine. In terms of commercial availability, it looks like, it will be mid-2021 when these vaccines would be available for manufacturing. What will happen in our view is that, once a company kind of does the phase 3 trials, which are very critical to, ensure the safety and efficacy of a vaccine, once they are done with that, and if the outcome is positive, these companies would license it to the other manufacturers. So, for example, if hypothetically AstraZeneca's vaccine is kind of approved for COVID treatment, then we have Serum Institute, which has some agreement with them to kind of manufacture for the Indian masses. Also, given it's a pandemic situation, I don't think the companies would try to look at profiteering from this. At the end of the day, it will be for masses, and therefore they will have these licenses, this arrangement with the companies to kind of produce it in a mass way. In terms of drugs, we've seen that, remdesivir, The innovator has licensed it out to 8-9 players. Indian companies, almost 5-6 of them, have that license to manufacture it. So all these large companies are manufacturing it here in India and are kind of, you know, selling it. So those things will play out. We don't know whether it will be whether we will see a vaccine which will give a full immunity. There are a lot of unknowns today, as to what will come first. There are many viral, diseases in the past like HIV, SARS, Hep C, which does not have a vaccine. But, they are kind of, treated with drugs. Some of them are, better treated with drugs. Some of them are managed. So we will see, what kind of treatment evolves for COVID. But in my assessment, vaccines should, come in a year's time. We will need to see the duration of immunity that provides, whether it will be shorter term, longer term immunity and all of that. But if that were to happen, then, in the listed space, we have companies like Cadila, who has, vaccines manufacturing ability. Then there is Bharat Biotech, there is Serum Institute of India, which has huge manufacturing capacities for vaccines. So they will kind of, produce it for the masses here.
So these are also the stocks that one should look at.
So we need to see, Serum, Bharat Biotech, they're unlisted. On the listed space, it is Cadila with some manufacturing capabilities. We need to see as to what is the kind of, overall opportunity, because here the price for vaccine is not going to be material. And also it's not going to be one single player who is going to address all of it. So it will be divided between many players, and therefore, this opportunity, it's difficult to put a number to, but will be a one-time opportunity in my view, unless this is a situation which turns out to be like a seasonal flu. Could not be something which is a longer-term opportunity to which one would like to give a higher multiple. So like IPCA, like Cadila, the way they have benefited in terms of, HCQ opportunity, there could be a scenario where benefit on account of vaccines as well.
But that benefit could be a little short-lived.
Yeah.
Yeah. And would we think similar for, say, a Torrent or a Laurus or Aarti Drugs? They also would apparently go in tandem with a moderate growth in the industry?
All of them, have different business model. Torrent is totally a formulations player.
Correct.
With a very high, skew towards India. And that too, within India, they have a very high share of chronic business. So we like Torrent, from a longer term perspective. This is one company which will continue to grow at, 8 to 10% top line and 15 to 20% bottom line. And therefore, the rich valuations, their margins are very superlative, because India business is very profitable for most of the players. So Torrent, over a longer period, it's a very good bet. Laurus, Aarti Drugs, the combination of API play, and today more so because of the improved outlook in API, these businesses have seen a re-rating. The caution I would give out here is that we need to see as to how sustainable this whole opportunity is. Clearly, the environment looks a lot better than what it was 5 years back. But will this be sustainable, and will it be for few companies or for everyone to kind of share? We need to kind of see. So clearly some re-rating is justified, but I would not want to extrapolate the current situation.
Correct. Thank you so much, Bansi. This was a very insightful session. I'm sure a lot of us have benefited and gotten great insights on a sector which is so complex and so much in discussion lately. Thanks a lot for your time, Bansi.
My pleasure.